Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all for joining us today as we introduce a package of legislative solutions to address housing needs for millions of New Yorkers. Before we begin, I want to recognize members of the Senate Democratic Conference who are standing here with me today. My deputy, Senator Gianaris, is here. Our housing rankers, Senator Adriano Espaillat, Senator Brad Hoylman is here, Senator Liz Krueger, Senator Belmanette Montgomery, Senator Gustavo Rivera, Senator Jose Serrano, and Senator Daniel Squadron. As we approach the end of this year's legislative session, there are many issues that must be addressed during the few remaining weeks. One of the most critical issues is the need to renew rent control legislation and improve access to affordable housing for millions of low-wage and middle-class New Yorkers. And let's be clear, this is not just a New York City issue. It's an issue that affects all of New York State. In my district alone, I have 26,000 units that are impacted by what we do here in New York State. The proposals discussed by my colleagues today will help ensure that New Yorkers are able to remain in the communities they call home. The Senate Democratic Conference has been clear in our commitment to renew and strengthen rent control protections and increase affordable housing options for all New Yorkers. So to begin the discussion, I'd like to introduce the Senate Housing Committee ranker, Senator Adriano Espaillat. Senator Espaillat.
Thank you, Leader. This is clearly a very important issue as it impacts over 1 million units of affordable housing, rent-regulated apartments in the city of New York and across other counties. And it's sort of like at the center of this whole debate about whether or not people can afford to stay in the neighborhoods in the five boroughs of the city and in other counties across the state. And so it's very much part of the income inequality debate. We've lost in the last 4 years 35,000 units of rent-stabilized apartments. In the last 10, 15 years, over 200,000. So things continue to get very expensive in New York State to live. And this is one of the issues that I think is right front and center with that particular problem. And we've introduced legislation, the Tenant Protection Act, which proposes to eliminate the 20% vacancy bonus, which landlords get when an apartment is vacant, also vacancy control. It also will restrict individual apartment improvements. That's another backdoor way of hiking the rent for many tenants. Succession rights. Many years back, the rights of nieces, nephews, uncles, and aunts, people that live extended family that live very often share an apartment because people cannot pay rent. So what we're seeing is many people bringing on their aunts and uncles and nieces and nephews to help them pay rent. They don't have succession rights when the main owner of the lease chooses to move or passes away. So we're looking to bring them back into fold, that they have succession rights. Also, as I said earlier, we repeal vacancy control. And also major capital improvement. You may know that also another backdoor way of hiking the rent is to make major capital improvements. We choose in this bill, the Tenant Protection Act, to cap it at 6% of the rent, but also to eliminate it once the owner has recaptured the investment of the improvement. So when you fix the roof or when you put a new boiler in a building, that improvement is passed on, the cost of that improvement is passed on to the tenant per room, in perpetuity, for life, way beyond the time that the owner of the property has recaptured that original investment. We think this is unfair, and so we're looking to cap it at 6% and also to eliminate it once the full amount is recovered. Also, rent control apartments. You know, we want to make sure that the 71.2% rent increases that can be imposed on rent control apartments no longer happen, that now they abide for the past 5 years with the New York City Rent Guideline Board's decisions to hike the rent for 1 year or 2 year leases. We also prohibit surcharges for tenants install appliances where the tenant pays the electric bill. So very often there's a surcharge for appliances even though the tenant is picking up the electric bill. So this is unfair. These are some of the very important provisions of the law. As I said earlier, we lost 35,000 units in the last 5 years. Some people say over 200,000 in the last 15 years. But I also want to address another matter, which I think is very important about this. And I think it's sort of like at the core. And in many cases, it's sort of like the dirty little secret, right? But we must really expose it. And I think that this is the first probably opportunity that we're going to get to see whether or not money continues to bully its way around in Albany and get their way. And so for a long time, we all know that the real estate industry interests have pumped money into campaigns, into government. And so here we are, you know, facing a decision that will impact over 2.5 million New Yorkers, the very essence of where they live, their neighborhoods. And so we'll, again, just play along and allow money to come in and push people around and get their way. I think this is, if we are to change the way we behave here in Albany, this is a great opportunity to do it, to finally say we have the interest of the tenants first and not the interest of money. Thank you.
Yours.
Sorry. It's okay. Sorry, that's okay. About that. No. I think
that's this yours, is that's good. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. You see how passionate our ranker is about housing and about the issues. And there are so many issues that you know, we have so many people who have their own reasoning by as it relates to these rent guidelines and how we can strengthen them. And so the next person that we will be hearing from is Senator Krueger. Senator Krueger.
Thank you. Well, I want to thank my leader for pulling us all together today. I'm going to start where Senator Espaillat, our ranker on housing, finished. I read in the newspapers this weekend that there were some colleagues from the Republican conference saying maybe we can't get any of these bills done this year because the people who pay us to stay here, they can't talk to us because they might be recorded or they might be involved in investigations. And I'm thinking, well, yes, we all know there are indictments going forth, there are investigations. I always say, assume anything you say here in Albany is being tape recorded by lots of different people, including you all today. Well, the concept that I have colleagues who say, well, if we can't talk to them, we can't get legislation done. I'm pretty damn confident the Senate, the Assembly, the governor, experts in housing, the state agencies involved with housing are perfectly capable of passing legislation that is good public policy for the state of New York. Now, it might not be what everybody wants, but when you're talking about what's in the best interest of the 8.5 million people in New York City, or all 19 million people, I'm just fine with special interest lobbyists not being welcome in the room or being afraid to come in the room because of the tape recorders and have their say. I think we should end up with better and stronger laws this year, and I see it as a great opportunity as the clock ticks to get that done. Now, the leader talked about a broad agenda. Senator Espaillat quickly went down through all the list. I've been asked to talk about just two of the issues that are bills that I've been carrying for years, and I don't care in what format anything passes. I don't care if it's a bill with my name on it. That doesn't matter. Two major issues for tenants in New York City. The major capital improvement issue that Senator Espaillat mentioned. So when an owner of a building does major capital improvements, it improves the value of that building, what he's going to be able to, excuse me, not to be sexist, what he or she is going to be able to sell that building for sometime in the future. So they're investing in their own property. But the way the law is now, the tenant gets that a percentage of that cost calculated and applied to their base rent forever and ever. So even when the owner gets a total 100% return on what they spent to improve the value of their own building, that they will also get value in if they choose to sell, they continue to collect a higher rent forever. It's patently unfair. It's very easy to explain why it's unfair. In the proposal that we are making, they can get the major capital improvement back from tenants under a specific formula until such time as they have recouped their expense, but it's not a baseline add to the rent. It doesn't add to the annual increase they already can calculate. It's a separate surcharge they can get returned, and when they are paid back, that is done. The tenant or future tenants are not obligated to continue to pay back capital improvements for an owner who's already been fully repaid, plus will reap the benefit of having a higher value building to sell. It's simple. It shouldn't be this way in law. We can fix it. Second, we have the issue of preferential rents. About 25% of the tenants living in rent-regulated housing in New York City have a rent that's actually lower than regulation would allow. The landlord has decided to give them a preferential rent. But then, particularly in quickly gentrifying neighborhoods, which is actually almost everywhere in New York City at this point in history, a landlord can say, okay, no more preferential rent, and skyrocket the rent from one year to the next by 20, 30, 40%, depending on the story of that building, of that neighborhood. It is disastrous for lowest income tenants who face the fewest options, and because of the loss of preferential rent, can absolutely lose their home and have nowhere else to go. So it's critical that we deal with that issue. And before I stop, just highlighting, every item that Senator Esbayat and Senator Stewart Cousins talked about our needing to fix this year, they're not radical new ideas. Almost all of them were the law in previous versions, and then because of, previous versions of rent regulation laws, but because of the powers of special interest and money, as my colleague Senator Esbayat explained so well, because of the power of money, those important things were taken out of the rent regulation law. We're saying affordable housing is a crisis for New York City, and hence is a crisis in Westchester, and actually for the whole state. And so we need to address this issue, and we need to be retroactive about some of the bad policies that were put into effect in the last two and three versions of rent regulation. And so when somebody says, well, don't you think you're asking for an awful lot? I would say, no, we've just lost an awful lot. We're trying to get back to some level of equilibrium for tenants and for the betterment of the state of New York. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Senator Krueger. I'd now like to ask Senator Jose Serrano to discuss the repeal of the vacancy bonus. Senator Serrano.
Thank you very much, Leader Stewart Cousins, and I'm very proud to stand with so many of my colleagues in the Senate Democratic Conference on this really critically important issue. I have a bill that I've carried for a number of years, S951, which would repeal the statutory vacancy bonus, which is a way for landlords to raise rent on a particular apartment whenever there's turnover of that apartment by 20%. And in certain neighborhoods and certain apartment buildings, conditions may not be that good. Tenants may come and go. They may choose to not stay. So an apartment can turn over several times in a relatively short amount of time. Moving the rent up by 20%, which is a very large amount, getting closer and closer to that vacancy decontrol threshold. Now, this has such a destabilizing effect on communities throughout New York City. And I really believe that affordable housing is the bedrock of our economy in New York City and in many other towns throughout the state. And if we do not have affordable housing, it will have such a tremendous negative ripple effect. Removing continuity in neighborhoods will be devastating to businesses, cultural institutions, schools. So really, I think it makes such good economic sense for business owners, for everyone involved, to have that level of sustainability within communities that can only be achieved through affordable housing and these very common sense measures that we're putting forth today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Senator Serrano. I also want to note the presence of Senator Jesse Hamilton. Lastly, we will hear from Senator Daniel Squadron, and he's going to be discussing the cap on rent increases allowed for individual apartment improvement. Senator Squadron.
Thank you very much, and thank you to my colleagues, to our leader, our ranker. And all of these issues we're talking about in many ways emanate from the fact that we have vacancy decontrol. It creates terrible incentives and, in fact, terrible outcomes for investors and landlords, terrible incentives and destabilizing outcomes for tenants and neighborhoods. And so the core of this is vacancy decontrol, which, as Senator Krueger pointed out, did not exist with rent regulation until relatively recently and only exists because of the way Albany doesn't work. To change the individual apartment improvement component of this essentially deals with the fact that right now, similar to major capital improvements, landlords are able to make improvements within apartments without any oversight as to the cost or quality or reality of those improvements, are able to jack up the rent on that apartment, including over the decontrol or deregulation threshold. And it happens in a way that's rampant, actually hard to measure, because it does not need to be authorized or approved by the state agency or any other oversight body. And this bill would change that. It would say that you can get paid back for individual apartment improvements, but over a more reasonable period of time. You can, regardless of the size of the building you own, you can make these improvements, but they need to be consistent with a reasonable set of costs and expectations. And there's going to be oversight and an ability for tenants and oversight agencies, the state agency especially, to make sure that there's no abuse. That is a core improvement that is necessary. It seems like common sense. The truth is, I look at my colleagues here, I don't know how many rent-regulated units you represent. 87,000, I think everyone here represents 10,000 or more. Yeah, I think you need to ask folks who oppose this how many rent-regulated units they represent. And if they are blocking improvements to this law, you have to ask them why they care so much. My colleagues have talked about it, but people whose major relationship with affordable housing and rent regulation in New York City and the surrounding counties is financial, should not be the ones setting policy on this issue in the state. That's why this is so important. This is policy that makes sense to everyone who's impacted by it, from the government to the neighborhoods to the academics, and that's why we should get it done. I thank my conference for being the leaders in pushing it forward.
Thank you so much, Senator Squadron. You know, again, I think that you can hear the passion for making sure that we, again, strengthen our rent control laws, strengthen our ability for our communities all over the state to have affordable housing, because that really is a bedrock and core value for what we in the Democratic Conference stand for. So I was going to talk about my vacancy decontrol bill. I think Senator Squadron did a fine job. In fact, I think each of us have articulated how important it is. And right, we don't need for anyone to explain to us the value of making sure we have strong rent control laws in New York State. We certainly, with all of the thousands of tenants that we represent, are very, very key factors in negotiating something that makes sense and ensures affordable housing going forward. So with that being said, are there any questions?
Does the conference have a position on the 421A abatement and whether there should be a prevailing wage component to that, or potentially increasing the number of affordable housing allowed under that program?
I think the conference realizes that reforms need to be made. We will be conferencing that today, and we are actually expecting to meet with the mayor later to hear his proposals. So we will be conferencing it today. Would you like to say something, Senator?
What I do feel is that to address 421A before the rent law, it's a terrible mistake. Because just think about it. You know, many people are just pushing to have a straight extender of the rent laws and get out of town. Now, the laws as they are right now have resulted in the loss of 35,000 units in the last 4 years. So to give, if you may, the real estate interest the ability to save another $1 billion without having any assurances whatsoever that tenants will be protected, I think is a terrible mistake. So, you know, we got to deal. This is a pressing issue. This is the number one issue impacting us, probably the post-budget issue, the one that impacts the most New Yorkers is this particular rent bill. So we want to see some changes, some dramatic changes that will help tenants. Families that are having a very tough time. The mayor agrees. We all agree. The mayor is pushing this bill as well very, very strongly. And we all agree that families are having a difficult time making ends meet because they can't pay rent. Simple as that. Rent is too high and they can't pay it. And so to just get out of town and pass an extender, the same way the laws are written right now, it's unacceptable. And then to sort of like sidetrack and then look at another piece of legislation, 421A, which there needs to be some reform, I think it's a terrible mistake.
But linking or including in that somehow more statewide tax policy, be it extending the tax cap, be it a STAR rebate program or a circuit breaker as the governor proposed earlier this year?
You know, again, I think that we are very, very clear on our priorities, and our priority is ensuring that people are able to live in New York. And so I know the linkages have been done before because, you know, the governor or has felt that that's the only way to get things done. We're standing here because we want to make it very, very clear that this is a priority for us. And, you know, we don't want to get out of town without doing what we need to do to ensure that, again, people have an opportunity to have stronger rent control.
Do you support outside of rent control as a separate issue? Do you support any of those tax proposals?
We've voted. This House has voted on the tax cap. We've voted on it, I guess, as recently as a couple of weeks ago. So there's certainly, you know, many of my members who have supported the tax cap.
And many that haven't, actually.
And many, many that have, and so therefore there are many that haven't.
To that point, though, on that Matt's raising, should the tax cap be viewed separately from rent control legislation? I believe so.
I mean, you know, I do believe so. Again, I'm in Westchester, and in Westchester, both of those things are extremely important, and I think each of us come with the view for the entire state. And we have to understand that New Yorkers are obviously concerned about taxes, and New Yorkers are obviously concerned about affordable housing. And, you know, again, I look at a place like where I represent Westchester County. I represent Yonkers, I represent Scarsdale, and New Rochelle, White Plains, Greenberg. There is no one in any of those communities that aren't concerned on some level about affordable housing. Even in a Scarsdale is, can your kids live in the community they grew up in? So the reality is that these are important issues. We need to make sure that people on every level of the income strata can afford to live in New York State. The people are our investment here, and we need to do the things that will preserve certainly the basic opportunities of housing for everyone. So taxes and making sure they are low are important as well as rent. So I don't know the need to combine them because I think individually they both matter.